repeat some things which I said last time to give a general framework. First of all, I'm discussing problems which interest me now, but one of the features of them is that they are not all prepared and packaged in a well-defined way. They are loose ends, and they are problems which I will, some we have already seen, and some more that we are going to address as we go along. The general theme which interested me here is, what does semi-classical geometry capture? What type of phenomena? And what is the fate of singularities of various types in string theory? The general tool one uses is the ADS-CFT framework, where in this duality type arrangement, actually the responsible adult is the field theory, and we try to extract as much information as we can from the quantum field theory in order to be able to extract various interesting qualities about what happens on the string theory side description. But in a sense, the QFT is a definition, or the non-perturbative definition, of the string theory side, up to maybe some loopholes which appear. But this is a general point of view. And I will repeat that most of the work I describe here was done with José Barbón from Madrid. Okay, so we spent quite a lot of time discussing field theory and correlations in field theory at large time. And I didn't enter, I will now, but I did not enter into the details of what precise two-point correlation functions I am calculating in the field theory. And it will turn out that the result depends very importantly on what these things, what these operators are. Now, in retrospect, it will come in a few slides, we will see that for chaotic operators, and I will try to define later what I mean by the chaotic operators, if one calculates a two-point function in a field theory which has in it a discrete gapped spectrum and is unitary, then there are some general features one can say. The first feature is that depending on which precise operators are chosen, there is either a power-like or generically an exponential decay in the beginning. However, a certain correlation function which we defined, which was the time average of the thing written above, integrate time average, taking that value squared, normalizing it by its value at zero, has a property that while it starts up at order one, by definition here, it reaches a certain lower bound around which it can oscillate a little. So I would say it's not a precise lower bound, but it is precise for the average of the square. It's not precise lower bound for the thing before being squared, but before being squared it would fluctuate around that average lower bound because it would have to reproduce it. So one has a decay. One begins to feel the fact that the spectrum is not continuous after a time which we call the Heisenberg time, which is order of the exponent of the entropy of this system. And then after a time of exponent of S, one approaches, which is called the Poincaré time, one approaches the original values to whatever precision you actually want. Now, the fact that we took this particular operator, and this Thibault asked me later, okay, so you took this operator, it's an operator, it's a local operator on the boundary theory. What does this correspond to in the bulk? So the general idea, but it was never proven, it is part of the, let's say, dogma in the field, which people are trying to probe and understand, is that the behavior of this chaotic operator corresponds to the behavior of a local two-point function in a background of thermal anti-de Sitter and in the presence of a black hole in anti-de Sitter. So the claim is that the way one captures the, let's say, black hole-ish or near black hole-ish properties of the system comes by this operator being chaotic. And the precise details of how locality is matched are not known and are not taken into account here. Now, we found out that if one looks at this correlation function, which is the correct answer calculated on the boundary, and compares it with the bulk result at a temperature in which is a temperature where a black hole dominates, let's call it the statistical ensemble, that is technically called beyond the Hawking page transition, which I described last time in some detail, how to construct it, how to Maxwell construct it, etc. Then there is a paradox, because in the presence of the black hole, calculating such a thing in a bulk would not show a lower bound, but this and the average quantity would go to zero instead of being bounded from below. Now, the remedy for that, for the average, was to suggest that one has to recall the other stationary point in the problem, which was the ADS, thermal ADS background. And I explained why in calculating in a background which is thermal ADS, the correlation, the average correlation function behaved exactly as it was expected with the same numerical values as what one got from the field theory. So one is relieved that the ADS-CFT correspondence worked, and one learned en passant that you have to take in the bulk theory at least two different topologies, which was always a question. Does one take the same topology? Is there a superselection rule which sticks you with one topology, or should you take several ones? And I also remarked that actually before this is due to Maldacena, there was at a higher level, it was shown that if you don't take the black hole when you take thermal ADS as a background, and you forget the black hole, which has a zero pi one, unlike thermal ADS, that you would again get a paradox. So these are two places independently where you needed to define the rules of the field theory so that you should at least take all fields which are solutions of equations of motion which have the same conformal boundary, even if the topology, when you look at the whole bulk, is different. So these were the various lessons that we learned. And then we learned that if one asks what happened at any particular time t, we totally miss the picture. Namely, we cannot reproduce by the thermal ADS, which does reproduce the average. It does not reproduce the more exclusive property, which is how the correlation function behaves at each time. So we learned that geometry can produce very small e to the minus s effects when they are averaged in one particular example. And on the other hand, we have seen that it did fail to get more exclusive properties. The simple geometry of just taking the two solutions didn't work. We discussed what happens if one tries to take more solutions. I won't repeat it now.
But does one, for instance, get the correct value for gamma, the decay time, as a quasi-normal mode?
No, because gamma is totally not universal. Gamma really depends on the details of the operator. The e to the s and the e to the s to the a, so on, these are universal. They only depend on the fact that this is a chaotic operator. On the other hand, the particular value of gamma does depend on which operator one puts on. And as one does not know the exact correspondence between the bulk and the boundary, this exercise, I mean, you can try and do it case by case, but you don't have a general picture like you have here. And people look at some specific cases, but the picture is not general. And we ended up with a question, which I will answer today. Was the failure of the thermodynamically dominant contribution to reproduce the average we defined quantum noise was the average value of the square of this operator. Was this an accident, or is this something which would occur in general in general under certain assumptions as usual? So again, the conclusions was what I wrote before, and that at that stage, the burden of proof that a well-defined information paradox exists shift to the claimer, that topological diversity is required, and string theory is quite a formidable bastion of consistency, because we did succeed to extract e to the minus s effects, which are not very easy to extract. So this is a summary of what we did in the last talk. Now, the fact that the burden of the proof shifted back to the claimer didn't mean that somebody won't lift the ping pong ball and shoot it again. And indeed, after this set of works have been done, another attempt to claim that the theory isn't well formulated came through claims that for various reasons, which would require a set of talk on its own, which I will not do here, is that actually whoever volunteered many years ago to parachute into a black hole just to see how he crosses or she crosses the horizon and to enjoy the experience would actually never enjoy the experience, would be boiled, and it would meet when they reach the area of the horizon, would reach a firewall where the temperature would be ill-defined, would be infinite, and the object would just boil. This has led to lots of exchanges in the literature, and from my point of view, the problem has not yet been formulated sharply enough to be able to decide one way or another, even though there are many people which would not share this opinion. But this is my own opinion. So I will concentrate on one particular round in this fight. Is there a firewall? Is the horizon something special? Or is the horizon, like we would think from GR, something that you could just cross using the equivalence principle as your insurance policy and nothing would happen? Or is this fallacious? And I will take one particular aspect which follows the theme which we discussed here. What does geometry capture and what does geometry miss? And this goes under the name ER equal EPR. ER is Einstein-Rosen, EPR, Podolsky is added to this. And the claim is that the various paradoxes, several of the paradoxes which were brought up, which led some to conclude that the simplest solution would be a firewall, other solutions would be more radical even, the problem gets resolved because entanglement issues can be related to the existence of Einstein-Rosen bridges. Again, it's very nice to discuss it. I won't do it here. I will just discuss the particular element in the controversy which relates to the theme we're discussing. So there was a paper by Maldacena and Susskind which said the following. Let's take the arguments that a group of people, Amhari, Marolf, Polchinski, and maybe the younger guys would remind me, I'm missing somebody starting with M, okay, or S, okay. Sally maybe, paradox is just not there. So they say, let's consider an eternal black hole in ADS. There are very good indications that an eternal black hole in ADS and its dynamics can be described by a product of two disconnected conformal field theories, each living on one boundary, and writing a maximally entangled state which would reproduce the geometry and the excitations of the geometry of the eternal black hole. And the state would be the following. You hear, by the way, in field theory one, the Hamiltonian and time, they have the same Hamiltonians. In one time flows this direction, in the other times flows in that direction. And each state here will correspond to some story in the bulk. So the state they take here is the maximally entangled state. They diagonalize each Hamiltonian. Then they take the product of eigenstate of the Hamiltonian N of field theory A, which is identical to eigenstate N and field theory B, and you multiply it by e to the minus the energy level appropriate for the state N, and you divide it by some temperature T, where this temperature T will define what is the temperature of the eternal black hole. So if you want to build a black hole of temperature T, this is where you put the parameter T. And the claim is that all the physics here would be the physics here. And in particular, if you look at this object, it has no firewall. So this is a situation which in principle would obey, would be one of the examples used by people who claim there are firewalls. And they say, look, here is a counterexample. So the debate did not follow about the counterexample, but about the genericity of the counterexample. The claim was that this is a very atypical case. And then Marolf and Polchinski suggested, okay, here I just remind you that if you look at a one-sided black hole, that is, you integrate over the other field theory, you will get a density matrix which will be appropriately describing the black hole. It won't play now any more role. So the arguments of Polchinski, Marolf and Polchinski, was the following. Say, okay, you took a very special state, which was a maximally entangled state. Why don't you take a state where you have a general NM structure here with some general matrix GNM and not insisting that this is a delta function. Look at this state and now calculate the two-point correlation function which we discussed before. And then they said, okay, we learned in the past how the two-point function behaves in the presence of geometry. And this is what I described to you. It starts being of order one, it decays, and then it reaches its average and jumps around the average with, from time to time, big jumps and mostly just very small fluctuations. And they said that if you calculate the noise, let's call it, in this configuration, you will not get this behavior, which we saw before. That was the claim. You will not, and the emphasis was here. They claimed that you will get that the height of this correlation function is of the order e to the minus s. You never reach a one. So it's not something which at least is known to be reached by a geometry, because when you look in the either black hole or thermal ADS, you get a totally different behavior. This will give you a different behavior. So for a generic state in the quantum field theory, you will not have a geometry, and therefore you cannot argue that everything is smooth. You just don't know what is going on there. You cannot ascribe it some particular configuration and say, look, here is a very unsingular, near the horizon, geometric configuration. Because the noise calculated in on the quantum field theory side does not correspond to anything that we know about geometry. And maybe there is something new about geometry, but then show it. But it's not our experiences in geometry. Okay, so this led to a second round of looking in more detail in all the questions of the behavior, the long-time behavior of the correlation functions. And in particular, a point which maybe was known to people, but let's say when I spoke about it here many years ago, definitely was not appreciated enough by me, is that the observables you choose and the way they how representative they are for the dynamics has a great influence on the results. So the things I showed you before and I emphasized work for chaotic operators are not true in general. One should really revisit this and study this for each type of operators. Now, in particular, as I told you, the common wisdom for what would represent successfully and give you features of black hole physics in the bulk, the claim was our chaotic operators on the boundary. And the chaotic operators were defined in the following way. They are supposed to be the representative operators. Again, doesn't mean they're not other operators, but they're supposed to be not representative. So how are the chaotic operators defined? So this is taken from things which were done many, many years ago in, let's say, fundamental quantum mechanics and statistical physics. It went under the eigenvalue thermalization hypothesis, eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. And the argument goes the following. They say that a general operator, which would be some Hermitian operator, does not commute with the Hamiltonian. And moreover, if you look at the eigenfunctions of this operator, they are highly uncorrelated with those of the Hamiltonian H. And these are the operators which you should measure their time dependence. And to be more specific, the claim was that if you look at that unitary matrix, which takes the operator, the generic operator, B, in the basis of energy eigenstates, and you diagonalize it, so B is in capital B, is in the eigenstates of energy basis. B, small b, is being diagonalized into the basis where its own eigenfunctions, that the matrix which does it is a pseudo-random matrix. So if you do this, if you make this assumption, so it's a strong assumption where you say you have a feeling on what is the right physics. And as I said, among the open, the loose ends, and people are working it from many points of view, is to give more and more basis for this foundation. Foundations to this claim. I will now just take it and show you just what are the consequences on the structure of a representative matrix B from this definition, from its definition. So the claim is, and I will show it, that a typical matrix or a representative matrix has some diagonal form. This is again written in the basis of energy eigenstates, on which there is nothing special to say. And then it has an off-diagonal form where you have some smooth number, small b, which multiplies it. This b will be relates, of course, the eigenvalues you have. This is written between an eigenstate of energy En and Em. And this is how you define E bar and omega. So this is some number which has no special characteristics. Then you get that the typical length or magnitude is of the order of e to the minus entropy over 2, which is a strong statement. So these are very small off-diagonal matrix elements, but they exist everywhere. Because this object here is supposed to be a random matrix of absolute value 1. So it's some e to the I theta, where theta is random. So this type of matrices are supposed to be the ones when one does the calculation. So how does one get this result? So in a very crude manner, let's look. The matrix U must be unitary, and by the assumptions that it's essentially all eigenfunctions of E participate in one eigenfunction of B, you get that each matrix element, they are E to the S matrix elements, so each matrix element must be of the order E to the minus S over 2. So this is now the U. B, the off-diagonal part of B, is U, some number B, U bar. So this would be a sum of e to the s elements of some random, because of their character, their product would be e to the minus s, because each is e to the minus s over 2. But then you don't get e to the s of them really summing together coherently, but because of the random nature, it's some random walk, and you get e to the s over 2. So that's how you end with this b being of the order e to the minus s over 2, and multiplied by some other stuff of order 1, which is random. So this is the picture one has, and as I told you, these were ideas borrowed by Asher Peres and Deutsch, Srednicki, from many years ago. So now one does, given that this is the matrix, which is characteristic for a black hole, what you should ask, what you should use when you ask about systems where black hole should be there, then, or for the system of n equal 4, that's the claim, you do the calculations with that. Now there are many type of calculations you can do, and I won't do all here, I won't show you all. There are some where you do the noise when it's one-sided. The EPR noise is of course when you have the, you're looking at noise, as I showed you, of a state n, m, with a matrix g and m between them. What noise do you get there? Then you have what happens, we'll discuss when there are several bands, and also when you have a system which is quasi-integrable. Okay, this is just to show you now that there are, you can do various things, you get various results which depend on many considerations. I'm not going to enter into all the details, I'm just going to give you the results that we are interested here, but I just want to know, to show you, because it was a lesson for us, that there is a lot of structure involved in which operator you choose to take, and what state do you take as a state you are interested in the system, which is a conformal field theory. Is it diagonal? Is it untangled? Is it pure? Is it mixed? All these things change, and each one gives different results for the noise. So now let's go back to the original claim. So Maldacena Susskind took the diagonal state. They said that is the state. You can go ahead and calculate the noise in that state. And of course here there is no horizon at all. No sign of singularity on the horizon. And you get the same result as I discussed last lecture. So this all looked very geometrical and very non-problematic. So we have the value of the correlator itself before being normalized is of order 1. It's characterized by the geometry, and the noise it gives is of the order e to the minus s times some numbers, which I didn't discuss anyhow. Now let's take the state which is non-diagonal and ask what happens there. So you can ask, what is the value at t equals 0? Or in general, what is the maximum value that you can expect this to give? But taking the lessons of last lecture, you can also ask, what is the average noise that this produces? So if one looks at the first question, was the one which was addressed by Marolf and Polchinski. Look at the correlation function and try to identify its maximum. When the matrix were the ones that we have discussed, and I remind you that R, M, Mn, as these random, there was e to the minus s over 2, which was multiplied by the order 1, but random phase which appeared. So when you look at this correlation function, you get this normalization structure. Then you have, because you're summing over n and m, you have these number of terms. You have these which have phases, and you have this torus of, let's say, e to the s dimensional torus, which you can build from en and em. Now, it is clear that each of the phases here is ergodic, so you can try and use part of it to remove the phase structure, the random part of Rmn, which you have for the general state. However, there is only an exponent s of such independent phases you can use. And you need, in order to make this of the order e to the s, that is to make all this sum coherent, you need e to the 2s terms, and you can't do it. So this won't help you. And what you end up is that when you look at a random walk structure here, you have only e to the s elements, which means that the maximum that this will ever give you is e to the minus s. And therefore, for a generic state in the conformal field theory, if you try and calculate what does it give, you don't get the geometrical picture, which is at least somewhere this was of order one, and it repeated itself, this order one, many times, very sparsely, but it was there. Here you cannot get it. Because, again, the argument, you have here a torus of phases, but these are not enough phases to get rid of the random structure of RNM. However, if you calculate the noise, that is the average value of the correlator, you do get exactly the same result as you got from the diagonal maximally entangled state. So this is another example of geometry, in this case, let's say, eternal ADS, which was really corresponding only to the maximally entangled state, giving you the correct, the exact and correct, sorry, giving you the correct average quantity. The average quantity was calculated by the geometry, very good. The moment you want to change and look into more detailed structure, like what is the maximum this has at a certain t? What, I mean, is there a t for which this be order one? The answer is no. Indeed, there, Marov and Ponchitsky stated correctly. This doesn't look like a geometry when you ask a very exclusive question. But if you ask an integrated question, you get the right result from the geometry. So this is example number two. And as I said, we show that it does not depend, the noise, the average noise does not depend on the entanglement. Then this is just a remark to people which were more concerned with this problem and aspects of it, that if you want to get an order one amplitude, which I showed you is not what you would get e to the minus s as a maximum, you need to have a state-dependent conditions. And indeed, some solutions of the problem of the firewall came through the direction of changing a little bit how the rules of the game are, and say that some of the particular things you measure are depend on the state where you are doing the job, you are doing the measurement. So indeed, never mind what, I mean, you actually know that this is what would diagonalize in field theory A, this is what would diagonalize in field theory B, this is a random part on matrices A and B. If you have a particular relation between the matrix elements, then for this specific operators, which is again type of question you asked me, Thibault, before, but these are operators which are, let's say, more interesting because they are space dependent, state dependent, because they depend on the matrices omega you needed to use for the diagonalization. If you take, if that is what happens, then you can arrange for coherence. But that's not the generic situation. So to conclude what we got here, up to now, we had two examples where geometry gave a number which was very small, the noise. It was e to the minus s. It's non-perturbative from the point of view of the gravity theory. It should be zero to all orders in perturbation theory. And nevertheless, geometry can capture it. But if you ask a more exclusive question, like how does it behave at any time t, geometry fails, doesn't give the right answer. Maybe eventually a way will be found, but as of now, we don't know. And the question could be so murky. I was using it as an analogy when people first thought that you could solve confinement by instantons in four dimensions. It didn't work. And then people began to look at various configurations. One of them were called Meyrons. And one started to invent more and more rules to try and get the result you want. But it ended up as a very murky subject, which actually did not lead to any concrete conclusions. And it could well be that the attempts to get exclusive information out of detailed semi-classical geometry will also end up being very murky. Maybe some nice structure will emerge. And I mentioned, let's say, the issue of the brick wall or the stretched horizon, which maybe by some way can effectively describe the sum over all kinds of things which are murky. But that's where the status is today. Averages of very subtle and small quantities are given by geometry. More details, geometry doesn't know how to give them, but you know the result from the field theory, but you don't know how to reproduce it from the bulk. At least there are no clear, there's not a clear calculation which produces them. Now I want to go back to more details about this. In particular, I'm interested in the detail, was it accidental that the low energy band that was thermal ADS dominated the behavior of the system and gave us the result we wanted? So here we take a matrix which has two totally, let's say, different structures in terms of number of states, which is characteristic of n equal 4. I showed you that there are actually four bands. Let's start, just a moment, just look at two bands. So there is one where there is a lot of states, very high, and there is one band where the number of states is very small. And the claim is that generically it will be that the low energy band will dominate. And how does this work? So assume there are a few bands. Okay, the system, it could be that the system doesn't have at all a band structure, and breaking it into pieces doesn't make sense. I tried to argue last time, and I will show again the graph in a few minutes, that in the system at hand, it does make sense to look at several bands. So the calculation I'm giving here, the estimates I'm giving here, are in the case when there it makes sense to look at the band structure. So if there are several bands, there is a probability that you will land in that band, and then there is the type of noise that you will produce if you are in this band. For example, when there were two, when we go back not to the field theory with the bands, but we think about the bulk picture, there were two configurations. There was a black hole with a certain temperature, and there was thermal ADS. And each one was given with the weight of the free energy corresponding to the Gibbons-Hawking calculation of the free energy of that system. So for a general object correlation function, you will give the probability that you are there, multiplied by what happens if you are in that band, what type of behavior you will get. And when you do this analysis, you expect, as I said, the probabilities will be related to the free energies, and the noise, we estimated how noise should behave, and noise goes like e to the minus s for the time being. We are looking about chaotic operators. So if we look at that system, we see that actually if we take the noise and we multiply it by the probability, which is a free energy, we get exactly the Boltzmann distribution, which will tell you that the low energy band will always dictate the level of the noise, the average noise. So this, it's a simple argument that was missed before, and it explains that you will, the fact that the thermodynamic dominating band did not give you the noise is not accidental. It's always the lowest energy band which will give you the maximal weight for the noise. That's statement number one. Now let's look at a case where the system is quasi-integrable. If the system is quasi-integrable, the relevant operators to calculate are not these ETH operators, but in that case they are clearly operators which are a few field excitations. That means there are some combination of A and A dagger, if you have some quasi-particle picture for that. So you can calculate what is the noise, not of an ETH operator, but an operator which has this structure, where the coefficients here are given by what you would expect, the Bose distribution in a system of, which is, let's say, quasi-particle excitations. And the result, which let's forget here the calculation, it's not important for me now, the result is the following. You would get that the noise is much larger. It goes like 1/√ of the entropy. So it's not the e to the minus s or s over 2 effect, it's just 1/√, having a much larger noise. So this is, again, to realize that when you do an ETH system and you look at its like long time behavior, when that is a characteristic operator, you get a very small noise. But if you are in a system which is nearly integrable or has lots of conservation laws where a quasi-particle, a free quasi-particle picture makes sense, you will get a much larger amount of fluctuations, a much larger noise. And that goes like 1 over square root of s. Okay, one can do the same for the EPR noise, and I emphasize again that the dynamic, the representative dynamics picks the representative observables and has a big change on the how the result looks like. Okay, I will come back to it. Here I can just say this is the type of field theory that we discussed in the ADS CFT. So this is on the CFT side. There are several bands. I told you these are gravitons, 10-dimensional. These are strings. These are Schwarzschild black holes in flat space. And these are Schwarzschild black holes in ADS. And there is this four bands that are expected from the bulk side. Okay, would be nice to get it, of course, from the boundary side. And here is what we discussed. Depends ETH or black holes and strings. You take the ETH, and for the gas, you take operators of the form that you discussed, which look like quasi-particle. So now you can do the calculations in these four bands. And here I will just give the final result. So if you look at the noise at a temperature which is much larger than the Hawking page transition, so where the black hole dominates the thermodynamics, each of the bands gives a certain answer. From here you get, from the graviton gas, you get the 1 over square root of s, and you get the various pieces, and you find that again, which is the leading one, and you get the same type of answers that we got before. It's the low energy which determines it. In general, you can say that the average noise is determined by the lowest band. The fast variations are also determined by the low energy band. On the other hand, the height and the long time variations, so which I show here, the long time variations and the total height, they're actually determined by the leading thermodynamical configuration. So if you would be listening to ADS, you are part of NSA, you listen to ADS, you know which are the pieces which you can associate with the low energy part, which dictates the average noise, and which are associated with the various time scales in the problem. So the conclusion of that part is geometry produces correctly the average property, which I would say now we have two average properties given correctly by geometry. It reproduced a very small non-perturbative result. It does not reproduce finer details of the non-perturbative behavior of the time-dependent correlators. So that's where we stand here. Slogans, I repeat, diversity counts. Geometry captures what I said. I think this is just repeating itself and just making the slogans clear. Okay, now you want to, do you think a 10-minute break would be good now? Or I go on? What do you say? Okay, so from now on, your responsibility is that we go on. Okay, so now I want to take a different diagnostic tool for the system. Before, I have discussed long-time correlation functions as a diagnostic tool. Now, I want to discuss complexity. Now, I will define complexity, I will discuss classical quantum, and I will calculate various properties of complexity of singularities. And we will try from them to learn what do singularities behave like. In particular, I'm telling you already now that some singularities will have a property which reminds you of things which Thibault liked to work, that is of systems where when you approach the singularity, you find a decoupling of different points in space-time, and you actually have like a strong coupling lattice system that is a very low degree of entanglement, and you just have each object obeying its own quantum mechanics. And similar things will, or ideas, or looks like that will come as a result of this analysis. But first, I need to define the complexity, what are its expected properties, and then what happens in the presence of singularities. Now, I emphasized in the beginning of the first talk and of today's talk that there has to be a responsible adult in the analysis, namely that one needs to understand how the quantum field theory works. And one has to have precise quantities and well-defined quantities in the quantum field theory. For the long time behavior, this was the case. Here, this will not be the case. That is, even the quantities defined on the quantum field theory side need have loose ends, and there are things one doesn't really understand in the definition of this complexity. And it will become apparent where the loose ends are, and hopefully eventually these will be closed. I think it's a very interesting line of thought. This was developed, I don't know, by, let's say, by Daniel Harlow, by Lenny Susskind, by Steve Schenker. Many people, let's say, in the Stanford group at one time or another spend a lot of time to push this this thing forward. They concentrated on analysis of black holes. Here I'm concentrating on, I will concentrate on the analysis of singularities, and we will have various type of singularities to analyze. So let's start with a definition. How does one classically define complexity? So here is a definition, and I think there are no precise, when we go to the quantum case, there are no precise data on how universal the statements are. Because I'm going to, the statement will depend on various inputs. And it could be that some features of the result depend on the input. I will tell you what is not expected to depend, but I don't know if there are theorems which validate that. So first, you're supposed to start with a simple initial state. A simple initial state means not highly entangled state. So you take some physical state, and this is a reference state for you. And one, again, the question how universal the answers will be and how much they will depend on what you picked is, I think, to some extent open. Then comes the notion of simple operations. I will give examples of simple operations. We are doing some classical system in the beginning, and then it will, the examples will become precise. You will see how to go on. So simple operations, I will give an example of a simple operation. Simple operations are supposed to be, if you have a state, it's given to you, then you make operations which are changes either at one point of this, which defines the state, or at a small neighborhood of that point. And you have a small number of these simple operations. Could be one, could be four, but a small number, much smaller than the number of degrees of freedom you have in the problem. And then you define the complexity of the state as a minimal number of operations you need to construct that state from the initial state. So here is a concrete example. Let's say that a state is defined by, there are S points in the state, and it's defined by being 0 or 1. And if you want, identify, you can have an overall Z2 identification or not, is up to you. A simple operation is that at one moment you take either 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, and you have S sites. Okay, is that? S will be like the entropy because you have essentially 2 to the S different states in this Hilbert space, so the log of it goes like S. So it's essentially, S is here, you should think of the entropy. Now, the maximal classical complexity for this particular problem, where this was the initial state, this were the operations, this was the system, is proportional to S, the number of sites. Is that okay, Thibault? Is that precise enough? So no. Okay, so this is the classical entropy of the system. When you do quantum mechanics, things become much more complex. Because the state now is a sum with complex coefficients of states. This is now the most general state of which you want to calculate the complexity. A general state in the Hilbert space, and remember we want now to give each state in the Hilbert space a number which will be its complexity, is 2 to the s or to the k or whatever number you want, lattice points you have here, and you have to tell all coefficients alpha I, okay? So you can be happy that there is one phase and one normalization, but this is irrelevant relative to the large number of information you have to give about the system in order to know what it is at all. So the manifold of pure states requires ab initio, in the definition, requires an epsilon resolution. Because this is a continuous manifold, this is the manifold of possible states, so there's no meaning of a minimal number of states, because that's a discrete notion. So what you need is first to already ab initio, on the field theory side, impose a resolution E, and then you can ask what is the minimum number of steps, and you will define what steps are. They can be, let's say, if it's a spin system, this could be 4 types of sigma matrices that you allow sigma plus to act on, let's say, 2 sides, sigma minus to act on another 2 sides, sigma 3 just to measure. You pick a set of operators and you move on the initial state and you ask what is the minimal number of operations you have to do in order to bring it into a region epsilon of the state that you want to determine its complexity. And that's the best you can do from the start. So that's why I told you that the problem of definition starts in the beginning, but people do it. People try to do this game, and the answer is, and I'll give some intuition to how you get it, is that there is a bound on the complexity. This was shown by Kitaev and the collaborator, whose name now escaped me, maybe you know. Who was? No, but okay. It's a 2 author paper. And the claim is that the complexity goes like e to the s times log of 1 over epsilon. And this is important that the resolution epsilon factorizes out. So you can identify a piece here which is epsilon independent, which is e to the entropy. So the claim is, if the total number of states of the system, let's say, is of the order e to the s, this is the maximal complexity a state can have. And we will see it's not as the answer may look trivial, but the consequences are not so trivial. And remember, it's very important to remember that this is not, we all think of the Hamiltonian or the transfer matrix as something which takes a state in time when it's not an eigenstate and moves it in the Hilbert space and tries to cover the whole Hilbert space in this motion. But that would not necessarily give the minimal number, the time it would take for a Hamiltonian of a system to get to the state we want to measure the complexity of is not necessarily the best shortcut. And this is one of the issues here, are for systems, what is the difference between the minimal number of steps? What is the time it will take to the Hamiltonian to do it? Is there another Hamiltonian where the time to reach the state minimally would actually be the time it takes the state to go from initial to final? And this structure of this is studied.
If the Hilbert space is the tensor product of n copies of plus minus,
for example, yes. It could be an Ising model. Let's make Ising model.
So
yeah.
The dimension of Hilbert space is 2 to the n. Then what is s?
S would be n.
N still Okay, still would be.
No, not the Hilbert space. This would be no.
The dimension is due to the.
The number again. The dimension of the Hilbert space is the dimension of this object here, because you have all the. Remember, I don't know how it's called. A Bloch space, I think. Sorry, you should remember it has all the alpha i's.
Yes.
Okay, and that's what dimension. So it's a dimension. So the dimension you should take here, this is e to the s times e to the s
yes.
Minus 1 over 2, Yeah.
And that space is CP is projective.
Some, yeah, indeed. But the projective gives you, okay, so it reduces by 1. That's because, as we know, there is a total phase, which is not important, and then there is a normalization, which is the other one which comes here. But basically, the large part comes from this. This cannot change. That this is e to the s times e to the s over 2. This is really the enormous dimensionality of that space. Okay, so if we look at that space and we put cells, then this is the number of, if you wish, that's an estimate to help you what you were asking. We have 1 over epsilon e to the s pieces, cells in that space. We have at each step of the order s choices to make. So in n steps, one can reach s to the n states. I act once, twice, so these are the number of states. Assuming no repetitions, I don't get stuck at a fixed point or something of that nature. So the complexity is bound from this. You see that the complexity is bound by e to the s. And that is the result that one gets here. Okay, now let's relate. This is the statements, which I told you are not sharp enough because we don't know the dependence on the initial state. We don't know how universal it is. The hope is that if the state is simple, then all most simple states would give a very similar definition to a complexity of a state. It's not clear exactly which operations I would do, and when, how many operations I'm allowed to do simultaneously, how large, if I have the state, on how many elements should I work simultaneously. In quantum computing, these are called gates, and you have various gates of the system. Again, the belief is that if the state is simple enough, that is, has a low original, the original state has low entanglement, and the operators that you act are local operators, and their number is much smaller than the number of sites of this lattice, then the results are more or less universal. This is the feeling, but as I told you, it's not much sharper than that. Now, how would complexity go for a black hole? And I will discuss we'll discuss that. So the idea was like this. If you have a black hole, its complexity in the beginning grows. Now, unlike the case we discussed before, actually here, nobody knows in the bulk why the complexity stops growing. But we know there is a bound. So
in the beginning, what happens to the black hole? This is not
I will show you the pictures.
The initial state we are talking about.
Yeah, so this, let me reach there. I will show you the geometry. Here, let me state the results, okay? And then I will show you the geometry which corresponds. You calculate various maximal volumes, and I will show you what that corresponds. You will see exactly what it corresponds to. So, in the black hole case, there is a period of linear increase of complexity, is a belief. It reaches, because of the bound, which you know from the boundary, it should reach a bound. At that stage, it's not clear what object that exactly will be, because we don't know the mechanism which will give that bound. And then, because of the Poincaré recurrences of the system will repeat itself. It will go down, go up again, go down and go up. So I didn't show you the intuition for this result. I will show in a moment. The time scales here are similar to the ones we discussed last time. It reaches a maximum time of the order of exponent of s, because the assumption is that more or less the complexity goes linearly with time. So the time it takes for this would to reach such a situation is e to the s, and therefore the complexity, this would fit the bound. And then it would go down again. Now this reminds us very much to the thing we had before, but in the inverse. Before, what we had is, we had something which dropped down. Here we have something which increases. It reached a bound. Here it reaches an upper bound. There it reached a lower bound. And then it repeated itself. Here we more or less understand how the lower bound, what is the source of the lower bound, and what is the source of the continuing structure. In the case of complexity, at least for me, up till now, I don't know what the mechanisms are supposed to be. Now, from what I understand from quantum information theory, it is expected that there are regions where such a system would indeed, as I said, the dc dt should be constant and c should increase linear with time. This t is temperature, it's not the time. And this is more or less given by dimensional arguments. And the claim is, and this is now a claim which one has to check, the claim is that the way to calculate the complexity is by taking the maximum volume, and I will show you of the system, and I will show you what is the maximum volume, how you define it at a given time. So here is now related to your question. So you start with a black hole. In ADS, this is all this thing. Otherwise, there's no connection to the CFT. So it's...
This is a small black hole. It's a large black hole.
At this stage, a large black hole. Okay, this is large black holes, and the temperature is above Hawking page. Okay, always. So there are no small effects which occur at temperatures which are lower than the curvature of the system. It's complicated enough like this. So you take it where the system is supposed to be simpler. That is, look at the temperature above the Hawking page. Then you start, this is the diagram which describes the whole, and you define the complexity in the following way. You take time on both boundaries to be the same. You could take them different. It doesn't matter. You could keep one of them fixed and let the other increase. That's wouldn't change the characteristic of the results. So given, let's say, the same time here and there, even though the calculations are done also for independent times. So you could have a TB here and a TA here. So this is anchored. Now calculate the volume of the various sections which are anchored on these two points. So there are many of them. Choose the maximal one. That will give you the complexity. This is the claim of what is the right thing to do. And the reason, it goes to infinity. Yes, that's a problem. So I told you one does not understand how, unlike the case that we had before, where we understood the lower bound and its source, in this case, at least as far as I'm concerned, maybe as some other people figured it out, it's not clear how a semi-classical picture will describe the saturation. Now, why did this come? How did this come about? What were the motives of Saskin that Al in proposing, in looking into that and proposing it? Because it's a proposal. It's not something that, I mean, it would be great if one could really prove that and do the exact mapping from the boundary to the bulk. But
so what is again the statement? Because, I mean, all those slices have an infinite volume,
no? No, you always remove, okay. That's why you asked about ADS. You always remove the infinity, and you are interested in the increase. You are measuring the increase. So you take the reference volume, you throw it away. Sorry, I should have said that. Okay? So you throw away the reference volume, and then there is something which increases, and that's what you want to focus on. You're not interested in the constant, you're interested in the first derivative. And it comes from, in the bulk, from the fact that as the time moves up, the extremal surface becomes larger and larger. So here it was like that, you'd go like that, ta, ta, the opposite. Okay? So what were the motivations? Where did they come from? Why associate this geometrical object, which you know anyhow, at a certain stage you will violate a bound, so it can't work all the way. But why do that? Well, there were several arguments. One argument came from the ideas of using tensor networks to build space-time. And when you use, which is another subject on which actually I'm not an expert at all, if you do these, you see that the time progression of building increases the complexity of the system in relation to its volume. So this was one of the motivations of why people wanted to associate this with that, with the complexity. The other reason is, this is more or less here, when you cut it, this is the length of the Einstein-Rosen bridge. And people wanted to understand how do the Einstein-Rosen bridge increase in time. It's originally not its volume, but people thought about the lengths. Now it was clear that the time scales involved here were totally different than the thermodynamical time scales. Because as we saw, thermalization is of order S in the system, or maybe even log S, but definitely not higher than S, the page time which we described. While the times associated with the Einstein-Rosen bridge increasing are e to the s. So that was another motivation to try and check if the volume will follow that. And the volume did follow that. Now I don't want to, I cannot accept this intuitive claim and see what follows up from it. Why this dictum is correct, especially because the authors several months ago had changed the dictum. And they said that instead of having here a volume, they want to calculate the action on the classical, what they call the Wheeler-DeWitt wedge of the classical action, which had the same, actually, for black holes, had the same or very similar properties as the volume itself. So, as I told you, we are here on territory for which we don't have the established and clean definition on the field theory side, because we don't know all details of universality of the definition. We don't know where, for example, the quantity epsilon, or it, again, I don't know right now, where the quantity epsilon would appear here exactly. In the calculation, the epsilon was crucial in order to make the cells on the field theory side. Where this epsilon appears in the bulk is not very clear, but remember that the whole point of Kitaev bound was that the entropy part can be isolated independent of the epsilon. So it's probably sitting in some coefficient multiplying it, but it's not important from the point of view of the S dependence. The S dependence was like e to the S.
I'm confused. On the undefined field theory side, we are talking about thermal states.
No? We are talking about the complexity, and we have a temperature, and this temperature take to the black hole.
Yeah, but we have no time dependence. I mean, the complexity should not depend on any notion of time.
It does. That's
because this is an eternal black hole. I mean,
no.
This is an
okay. Sorry. Maybe I jumped here once. You ask the question, I give you the answer. So forget now the black hole, think of the field theory.
Yes.
Okay. So now, the field theory, we want to map the whole Hilbert space. Mm-hmm. There are many ways you can map the whole Hilbert space. You can go and pick your trail and go in it. But one way to map the Hilbert space is let the Hamiltonian develop the system. So take a state, which is a simple state, and at each time t, I beg your pardon? I don't want an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. If it's an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, it's not a good way to be a tourist.
Pure.
Yes, pure, but not eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. I get a well-defined state. I let it evolve in time first. I can afterwards do a thermal average of it. That's not the point. The point is I let it develop in time. As I develop in time, I reach every time a new state. I ask, what is the complexity of that state? Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's where you get this thing. But you have to remember that the complexity of the state could reflect a smaller number of operations than the Hamiltonian that took you there. So you let the Hamiltonian evolve it. So your first jump would like to say, the complexity is just related to the time after I change the units appropriately. It's the time it took me to reach it. But it's not, because that is not necessarily the minimal number of steps that you would have to do to reach the state. And the minimum number of steps is not defined by the Hamiltonian. It's defined by some other quantity, which is simpler than the Hamiltonian. So this is how the question of time dependence of complexity comes in. And this is why you know there is a bound, because eventually, once you cover the whole Hilbert space, it's over. You're not going to get that it takes, whatever you get, the highest complexity took you to reach a state, after you covered the whole Hilbert space with your time, you're not going to get anything more than that. But you also have the issue of Poincaré recurrences. So that will follow, you will go to states which have lower complexity as you move on. But the existence of the bound is clear, because there is the most complicated state given a certain epsilon. Is that helpful?
And if I'm in the Heisenberg picture, does it change the idea of complexity?
You will find, you will do it with the operator. So you will ask how many, this is much better for mathematicians. You would have some matrix, and let's say some unitary matrix, and you will ask by small unitary or emission matrices, how many times do I have to multiply to get the matrix which Heisenberg gave me. So both pictures should give you can ask the question in both pictures. It's a question of if you want to act on the state or want to act on the operator. Okay, so as I said, in the bulk it's conjectured to be the maximum value, and it comes actually with one more statement, and the statement is, okay, which you could see here, and that's why it became more interesting. The state was like this, that, and it was born by calculations done when you add perturbations to just this development described here artificially, if you wish, but well-defined in the presence of the black hole. You can also add shock waves and see what happens when you add shock waves to the system. And the claim was like this. If you have a system which is thought to be the black hole, where complexity increases, then there will be no problem at the horizon. The horizon should be non-singular. If, on the other hand, you have complexity decreasing, then the horizon would be singular. And very proudly, they show that in this case, there is no problem, because the complexity all the time increases, and therefore there is no singularity on the horizon. And they did examples by adding a shock wave. So they could see where you could have a singularity, but then with a small thermal photon, you would get rid of the singularity. And because it would shift enough the horizon so the system could develop without any singularity involved. So they gave a lot of examples in the context of black hole physics that it makes sense to think that indeed when complexity increases, there is no singularity. And the wish here was to say, there is no firewall, because in this situation, which has some generic properties, you actually have complexity increasing. And as I said, the things which are unclear, what exactly corresponds to the complexity on the conformal field theory side in the bulk? What is this mechanism which stops the complexity increasing, because it must reach a maximum? So is there a semi-classical picture? Maybe there isn't. But is there a semi-classical picture which we say is a stop? The advantage is that you introduced here an extra time scale, an extra object which happens, an extra mechanism which happens, the increase in time of the Einstein-Rosen bridge, its length or volume, which is not a thermalization scale. All this happens way after thermalization has been reached. So if you made a perturbation, you thermalized, all this happens way afterwards because you have time scales of the order e to the s.
Anyway, I'm confused by something else.
Please.
This is time symmetric, so the, if I start at the bottom, the complexity or whatever will decrease to a minimum and then increase.
No, well, what you would say here is that you reach a singularity. So
not
this...
Singularity is up there and down.
No, but here what they would say, by the time reversed thing here, that's for them an example of why in the presence of a singularity, why complexity decreases when a singularity is there. Yeah, that's for that one, but there is a white hole somewhere here.
And another question, if I thought one was supposed to have reverse time.
But remember, we didn't even reach here the horizon, forget the singularity.
I take slices that do like this, they will always have the same Einstein-Rosen bridge, no?
No, you no. Again, what you need is, you can do, and they did it, take a general TB and the TA. And analyze how things behave as a function of
t. If I do this, I have always the same cut, and there is a symmetry.
If you use boost invariance,
yeah.
So okay, but that's a very particular case.
But this is a natural thing, no? No,
I don't see why the boost case. I mean, the boost case is the one where you will see the invariance, but
yes.
You want not to see the invariance. The whole point is not to see the invariance, so it's right. You can arrange, you will get a function of TB minus TA, and you can arrange, use the boost, you can arrange whatever you want, but the generic case, take TA and TB and just let them vary each one independently, you will see the complexity increase. Keep one fixed, keep the other fixed.
So. But if they are correlated, then it's
no, again, the issue is not finding things which won't do that. The issue is to find something which will measure it. And they suggest, they want to measure the quantity, they want to measure it, and they suggest that this is the quantity which will measure it. You are suggesting quantities which will not measure it. Okay. But they know that complexity changes in time on the boundary. I think this is clear, independent of universality issues.
But what is not clear to me is that if the state on the boundary is not, I mean, if it is a thermal state, a bathymal state, and everything is a eternal black hole inside, then okay, nothing depends on time, I don't need to ask this question.
Yeah.
So now I need to start making some action indeed in the CFT to create to start with a simple state, and then it develops in something complicated that thermalizes, but then it won't be at all a black hole like this in the middle, no, it will be something else. That will be totally dissipated.
No, why? That's what I said. They do perturbations. They can do perturbations around this.
Yeah, but this is a bad thing to perturb around, because if I have a big thermal state and I add a little bit of things...
I don't know. Look, let's discuss afterwards. Maybe I don't understand exactly what you say, but let's discuss.
I would understand.
No, well, I have 5 minutes, so let's discuss afterwards. It won't. We won't know. Converge to that. Okay, so, with 5 minutes, it could be also a moment here. Where are we? Okay, so they give a motivation on why they want this object, and as I told you, anyhow, it got changed. But I think the motivation is not empty. It's interesting enough. And there are interesting enough questions to pursue which are not clear, and the problem looks very similar as one over the problem, the S-dual problem of the long time correlation functions which have a lower bound, here you have an upper bound, very similar type of behaviors. They calculated according to their definition what happened for black holes, And what we calculate is what interests us for, and this I will discuss the next time, what happens in the presence of singularities. And we will do the same calculations, but we will do them for various singular backgrounds, including the Kasner case, including other cases, and I will describe what types of singularities one is interested in. And maybe I will, and of course we can discuss next time if you want more of the motivation of the group, why they think it's an appropriate thing for complexity. What I want to end now is actually something which I will use the blackboard just to amuse ourselves, because I'm going to use this for next time. But there is nothing yet to erase, but there will be. Okay, so we all know that in quantum mechanics, with a potential x to the n, there is no perturbation that you can do. You are familiar with the fact that if you have this system, you can always...
And it's even or
This is the issue of a ground state, but for the problem I'm going to mention, it could be anything. You can always turn this into a problem where you have the energy scale sitting here, multiplying this by two operators which come with an equal weight. So that means that perturbation theory means nothing for this problem. You know the harmonic oscillator, and here you would get h bar omega as a function of the Hooke coupling and the mass of the particle. And this is general for any n, almost. So that such problems in quantum mechanics don't have any perturbation. You cannot make perturbation. All the relative couplings do to you is give you the relevant energy scale. Now you know there are many arguments you can say where perturbations are. These are not bounded, neither operator is bounded. So if you take m to infinity, it doesn't mean that expectation values of p won't grow to infinity. So maybe it's not just a classical problem. And if lambda goes to zero, you don't know that if expectation value of x to the n will not contra the simple lambda dependence, and maybe, but without all this, you just do a simple rescaling and you get that this is the case. Now there are two cases where this is wrong. So let's say one case where my statement was wrong and one where you can do a trick. So the case when my statement is wrong, I want to discuss, that is everything I told you, if you do the exercise of rescaling, you will find it works as long as n is not minus 2. If n equals minus 2, you cannot do the trick. Namely, the coupling which would appear here for n equal minus 2 is a real coupling in the problem. This can also, if you want, be an example of an anomalous dimensions in quantum mechanics, because things will depend, behaviors which you do by scaling arguments would suddenly depend on the coupling. And this particular problem, which is of the form p squared over 2m plus, let me take, in general, if g is positive, the system is, I will describe its properties, but it's well defined. If g is zero, it's a free particle. If g is negative, I don't remember the normalization, but g in absolute value when g is negative, in absolute value, it must be, I think it's 1/4, but maybe it's 1/2. I don't remember. It's one of these numbers. And beyond that, this is not a self-adjoint operator anymore, and you really introduce by hand a singularity at the origin. But as long as this is not happening, in none of these cases will you have a bound state, and the system will behave in the following way. So let's take G positive. In the case where G is positive, you have a potential, actually, you, if if it's one dimensional, then the space broke in two. If it's more dimensions, then it's just the radial part of it. But let's take one dimension. So this system you can solve exactly. Of course, like in a free particle case, you won't have anything in L2. But you will have, for any energy E, which is larger than zero, you would have states which are plane wave normalizable. But for E equals zero, you will not have a plane wave normalizable state. The state will be, its normalization will be worse than plane wave. And therefore, you have a very interesting system. It is, the spectrum is continuous, bounded from below, but does not have a ground state. If you wish, time translational invariance is broken in this quantum mechanical case, because you don't have the lowest energy state of the system. And it's interesting what properties the system has, and I'm going to use it in the next lecture. So I wanted to introduce you to it. I will also mention again, there is now something more fashionable. This is something which was discussed from my point of view by Sergio Fubini, De Alfarlo, and Furlan many years ago. I did the supersymmetric case with Fubini, but the main structure is already there before you do the supersymmetry. And this model is called conformal quantum mechanics because it has a symmetry which contains, you have the operators H, D, and K. I will discuss them. The operator H translations in time, D it measures the scale, and K is the special conformal transformations. And this is just xp plus px, and this is x squared, and they close on an SO2,1 symmetry, which is exactly the conformal invariant. So it's a very interesting system. Now, recently, in recent days, months, people are looking for another type of system, which is called, related to the name Kitaev again from a different point of view, and they're trying, instead of having this model, having here a Schwarzschild derivative, here you have just x dot squared over 2m. They are trying to use a Schwarzschild derivative and get another type of conformal model. This I will not discuss, but that's now part of ADS-CFT. It's a, let's say, a hot topic of research. I will use this model in order to discuss possible how singularities behave in string theory using ADS-CFT. So I think by this I exhausted this lecture. And we remain, I will maybe prepare for Thibaut for the next lecture. I can review in more detail the motivations of Susskind et al. If you want. That's it.